Congressman Peter DeFazio's community forum, which I emphasize a community forum because this is a unique forum. It's a unique forum for a time that is not an ordinary time. There are members of Congress who have decided not to show up to their town halls, their town meetings. But Congressman DeFazio has arranged this forum to speak to us correctly, but to speak about the serious issues confronting our community and our nation. He is the man we've chosen again and again to represent us in Washington. We depend on his leadership. Side a little bit about those values, because those are the values of my city, our city, the city of Corvallis. It's the fabric that connects us. Our city honors diversity, inclusion, freedom from hate. Our charter. Our charter, perhaps uniquely, I don't really know for sure, commits us to exercise our power to ensure equal protection, treatment, and representation of all persons without discrimination. For years, this city has been acting like we were what is today referred to as a sanctuary city. We've gone and reinforced that with the city council resolution at the end of last year. But I would argue that. So those values are under attack, and I'm delighted that Congressman DeFazio has decided to have forums like this so that we can talk about how to defend them. We do have limited time today. Not everybody's going to get a chance to ask a question or to offer their views. I just ask all of you to be thoughtful and respectful of one another, and let's learn from our contributions. So before I start doing other introductions, I would like to recognize the elected officials in the audience today. I'd like to start with my own city councilors. I know I saw one on the way in. If you could stand up and be recognized. Bill Glassmeyer and another council. And then on the look for county commissioners. Any county commissioners today who I didn't see? I don't see anyone standing up, so perhaps not. I know there are school board members here today, since I saw several over on the side. Finally, I've been dealing locally, so I do want to recognize and acknowledge my co-mayor from across the river, mostly across the river, Sharon Canoco from Albany. And now it's my distinct pleasure to represent my favorite state senator. Favorite state senator, yes. Senator Sarah Gelsman. I just wanted to end that saying another defender of our values up in Salem rather than in Washington. So.
Is that as Oregonians, as neighbors, We are jointly committed to the values that we hold dear, that build the communities that we love and care for. And that's what I'm committed to doing in the legislature this year and in years to come. I'm so grateful.
They had a They were going to roll out stuff in the first week and 2 weeks of the Trump administration, and they did a number of things. I mean, the Muslim ban, you know, the executive orders repealing laws to protect the environment, dismantling anything that acknowledged climate change. Then now we've moved on to the proposal for mass deportations. They're going to repeal Obamacare. The list goes on and on. And they thought we would be discouraged, demoralized, disorganized. Boy, were they wrong. I was inspired to do these meetings because I heard from so many people contacting my official office where I can't advocate for organizing and doing electoral stuff, saying, what can I do? I've never been involved before, what can I do? How many people, I know there have been other forums this year, but let's just say this year, how many of you are getting involved at this level for the first time this year? They have activated the silent majority, so to speak, healthcare for 23 million Americans. Well, now the reality is setting in with them that maybe it's not that easy, and maybe they really can't take away healthcare from 23 million Americans and not pay a very heavy political price. We are speaking up and out in a way that is already changing their actions. They passed a bill the first week to begin the process, and we were going to be well dispatched by the end of February. Well, we still haven't seen the replacement plan, and they're internally falling apart over how are we going to do this? And that's because of citizen action, and we've got to keep that up. Martin Luther King marches I usually do in Eugene, and it was the largest one I've ever seen. And, you know, people there had observed, and they're afraid about voter repression, and going back to a dark time in this country that my friend and colleague John Lewis had his head bashed in over, which was civil rights for all Americans, the right to vote, the right to participate in our process. They're so worried, people are so worried about that. That was the biggest I've ever seen for MLK Day. New energy that's out there. And then finally, the Women's March. it was kind of sad, but I'm going to say somewhat amusing to see the press secretary, Spicer, on that Saturday go out and berate the press about how Trump's crowd was bigger. That was, of course, and defending alternate facts, as we have now come to learn. So that was the real wake-up call to them, that this is not small, and it's not going away. And I think it's getting bigger every day. So it's given me new hope. And that's why we're here today. I sponsored this with my campaign because, unlike my regular town halls, which I do all around, I can't at a town hall advocate how to organize and what we're going to do. So this isn't about my campaign at all. This is a campaign for all of us. It's a campaign to restore American values to our government. That's why we're here. Just to help channel some of that energy, and then I want to hear your thoughts. We're going to have three mics. We'll have one up there, and I'll go back and forth down here a couple of times, and since there's fewer people up there, then we'll go up there and try and get through as many questions as we can, or observations or quick statements about what you'd like to do or think we should be doing. What we're looking at here, I got my notes out of order in Eugene. I don't normally talk from notes, but there's a number of points I really want to be sure that I cover as we go through this, because this is an unprecedented time, as the mayor said. So, thanks for that. All right, we're here. So, we're doing things on both sides and all sides of the country. We've been very active in Washington. I've been very active in Washington. trying to push back against what this administration is doing. I've introduced, I mean, he promised to drain the swamp. This is the swampiest cabinet I've ever seen in my life. But the draining the swamp was really about his 3,600, unfortunately, high-level political appointees he gets to make. For 5 years. Well, it's not enforceable, so I said, well, I want to help them out. So I introduced a bill, the Drain the Swamp bill, that would make that a statute, that they can't work 5 years as lobbyists and they're prohibited for life as lobbying for foreign interests. That's what he wants. I'm on the Senior Democrat Transportation Infrastructure Committee. We have jurisdiction over public buildings. And the lease with GSA and the Trump Hotel is in our jurisdiction. Elijah Cummings from Oversight Investigations, and I have been pursuing this since the day he got elected with the Government Services Administration. There is a clause in that lease. It's a standard clause. It's a clause that has been in every federal lease since sometime around just after the Civil War to take care of carpetbaggers, and it said, no elected official of the United States of America can benefit from this lease. That could not be more clear. Now, we, Elijah and I, went to talk to GSA and said, what are you gonna do about this? And they said, well, that's prospective, we don't know. And we said, we wanna have a meeting. So we got a bunch of them to a meeting with our staff, and in fact, they said, yeah, it's clearly a violation. He has an 86% personal interest in that lease, 86%. And so, that, unfortunately, one of the staffers leaked that and got in the press, and then GSA said, oh, wait a minute, we can't tell, really. And so we're having trouble getting GSA back to enforcing the rules, but I think there may be litigation filed on this in the not-too-distant future. Now, in the House, the Speaker is supposed to be the Speaker of the whole House. Doesn't even have to be a member of Congress. Not totally partisan, obviously, he is. But, you know, so every senior Democrat, every ranking Democrat on every committee, we wrote a letter to him as our speaker, asking that in the national interest, that he should request Trump's tax returns.
Yeah!
Interrupted the proceedings with the privilege motion. The privilege motion, and if you watch this, it's classic because the chairman from Texas is sitting there. And Bill says it's within the jurisdiction of this committee under statute to request the 10 knows Mike was hot goes, oh shit. So, we lost on a partisan basis, but we'll see how long that wall holds. This was done actually in the Nixon era. By the Ways and Means Committee, and it helped accelerate Nixon's departure from the White House with the tax fraud. I'm very worried about issues of war and peace. To tell the truth, I'm actually pretty pleased with General Mattis and think he's an adult with a strong history. He's known as a warrior monk. I don't think he's going to get pushed around. I don't think he's going to get into foreign adventures. We shouldn't. But then again, with Steve Bannon, head of the National Security Council, who knows what's coming? I'm also on a bill to say you can't put political appointees. That's kind of a but I'm worried that there's a rumor of ground troops in Syria, so I introduced a war powers resolution saying it is the only purview of the United States Congress and the Constitution of the United States to deploy in a discretionary manner, not in immediate defense of our country or our citizens or our troops, in a discretionary manner, our troops into war, and the President must come to the United States Congress and ask for consent before he can do that. For now, most of that isn't going anywhere. The House is a winner-take-all institution. We can trigger votes. There's another vote that'll happen this week, but I can predict it now. Jerry Nadler, a good friend of mine from New York, introduced a resolution of inquiry for anything and everything the Justice Department has on the contacts with Russia, any potential violations. So they have to actually take it up and vote on it. I predict it'll be, at this point, still a party line vote against, even though there's some growing nervousness on the Republican side about how serious this Russia stuff might be and what the president's involvement or what they might have on him. We don't know. So that'll happen, and then that kills it. On the Senate side, actually, because you've got a couple of senators like John McCain and Lindsey Graham, who take national security very seriously, they're actually proceeding with an investigation in the Intelligence Committee. And our senator, our senior senator, Ron Wyden, sits on that committee. I'm sure that there's going to be some attempt to, you know, maybe not go too deep, but I don't think Ron and others are going to let him do that. I'm very hopeful that that will get us some information that we need about what's really going on here. In the House, Jason Chaffetz, who chairs the Oversight Committee, has said he's still very interested in using his subpoena power in investigating Hillary's emails.
Yeah.
So, you know, they're stonewalling us, but you know, that stonewall is only going to last as long as Trump's numbers with Republicans are in the 70s. And I think that's not destined to last. And we've already seen a few members. I just saw something shocking. Daryl Issa from California asked that a special prosecutor or this is the point of being here today. It's not a coincidence that Daryl had the closest congressional race in the United States of America, that he's suddenly taking a progressive position, having been a big fan of Donald Trump previously. So that's what I want to talk about, and that's why I want to do this under the auspices of my campaign. We are already organizing nationally. We need 24 seats to take back the House of Representatives. We have 23 Republicans who won in districts that Hillary won. We have another couple of dozen in districts that were won rather narrowly. We've already hired 20 organizers to go into those districts. We're ultimately going after 50. So we're going to have professional organizers here starting now. And we're going to invite people nationwide to participate in this process. Now, you can, you know, these days you can phone bank from home if you got an unlimited plan. You don't have an unlimited plan, we'll get you a phone. You know, you can also, you know, I'm going to ask some people, you know, and I'm going to make it available to people. If you want to travel to sunny Southern California a little later in the cycle, go knock on some doors. We can help. We can help arrange the application. All across the country, so we've got a network with our friends and families and anybody we know in these districts, in these targeted districts. This is well within the realm of possibility. I feel it when you see half the people in this room haven't ever participated in something like this before. There is new energy out there that we can channel, and we can get our government back in the next election. I want to get parochial for a minute. I had the privilege of representing the most closely divided district in the presidential race in the United States of America. In my district, Hillary got 46.1, Trump got 46. She won by 504 votes. You know, we got a little work to do here at home, too. And this is going to be a little bit of a, you know, a caution. I would urge everybody, I mean, not that the Gazette Times is a great paper, but the Guard today, and I don't know if they ran it, ran a Christoph editorial. It's the second one he's written on this. Op-ed. Don't go out and paint all the people who voted for Trump with a broad brush and alienate them. And the first one he wrote, he apparently got viciously attacked and trashed, so he wrote another one saying, really? I mean, think about this. I know people. I know I do know people who voted for Trump. In the rural areas of my district, other people are hurting because they didn't feel that their needs were really being addressed and hadn't been addressed. I approach politics like Maslow's hierarchy of needs. And up here is the most basic stuff, survival for you, your family, your shelter, you know, good education for your kids, opportunity, a job, healthcare, other things. Those are all essentials. And there's a lot of people who feel left behind. After NAFTA passed, which I bitterly opposed, I met with workers who have been forced to crate up their machines and put them on trucks headed over the border where people can be exploited, where labor unions aren't allowed, and where they dump the waste out the back door. Now, you know, so there were people, particularly in the Midwest, people forget, we lost the Midwest in the congressional elections of 1994, put Newt Gingrich in power, because Democrats in droves stayed home. Because they said, Clinton did this to me. My job went to Mexico. So there are people who have been hurting, they're angry, their people are angry about what happened on Wall Street. One of the proudest days of my life was the day we beat the Wall Street bailout in the House of Representatives on a Monday night. I was one of the leaders in that. But then 2 days later, the Senate comes back to town. They vote to bail out Wall Street, and a bunch of my colleagues got scared because the stock market dropped 800 points, and they said, oh, I've got to change my vote, and we bailed them out. If we hadn't bailed them out, we'd be better off today. A couple more of this. And then comes President Obama, great president in many ways, but Wall Street in jail, back to Eric Holder, is back in his corner luxury office on Wall Street, which they kept open for him the whole time he was attorney general. That made people really angry. People lost their homes and their savings. They were stolen from them, essentially. We have a Secretary of the Treasury who took away 36,000 people's homes. Mr. Mnuchin. That's how he got rich. So rich, he forgot to put a $100 million asset on his disclosure form, which he made by taking away people's houses. So people are angry. Their jobs are gone, they lost things and that, and they voted for change. They didn't vote for Trump. There's a large percentage of the people who voted for Trump who don't believe he's qualified to be president, but they wanted change and they didn't see Hillary as a change candidate. So don't go out and beat them all with the wrong price. We've got to bring some of these people back. We need them. We could put the money we need in our schools and healthcare and other essential services in the state. So what happens here at the state level? I have in my district two very close state rep races and one very close Senate race. We saved them all, Democrats. But you know, we're going to have that challenge again. And if we could get a couple more, then we can do what needs to be done to fix our state properly. And then the other threat: we're going to get another congressional seat. And we're going to redistrict the state legislature after the 2020 census. We're going to pick up another congressional seat. We'll have six. This could be mischief. It could be great. Secretary of State Richardson, the first statewide elected Republican who happens to be a very right-wing Republican, who is against vote by mail, would like to have voter ID laws like those that have been thrown out by courts in other states, has commissioned his own little rump group to talk about the problems of redistricting in Oregon. What are the problems of redistricting? We had a bipartisan redistricting that wasn't challenged in court, that it was so fair, the first time in 30 years. He thinks that's a problem. He wants something different. Well, I think what he wants is what other states have done, which is to gerrymander their states to get a certain result in the election. We cannot let that stand. That needs to as many folks as we can. So I'll go right here first. Ready? interrupt.
Corvallis, we've met before. I really appreciate your emphasis on the need to maintain and to develop infrastructure in the United States, and I think that's admirable. It's a good place where we should be investing. However, there's one aspect of infrastructure that I think is being left behind, and that's the atmosphere of the whole globe. I think that's the basic infrastructure needed to maintain. And I guess there's a couple of things that I'd like to bring up on that issue of climate change. One is I think we need to stop all new fossil fuel investment in this country as quickly as we can. I mean, maybe, we can't just grind to a halt or, put a wall and say no more. But I think we've got to say very soon there's going to be no more investment in fossil fuels. And so what can we do now to stop, like this Dakota Access Pipeline and other similar big energy projects that really destroy our planet? And the other thing is that the necessity of putting a price on carbon. So while we are still using carbon, we provide a financial incentive to get people moving in a more sustainable direction and to meet our energy needs. And along with that, of course, I want to mention the bipartisan climate caucus. And have you had any thoughts about joining that caucus? That shows that there is some solidarity with Republicans who are willing to take climate seriously. So a lot of topics. Thank you.
Sure. I go through real quick. Fossil fuels, certainly for now, that's going to have to be. We couldn't even get a national standard for renewables, through when the Democrats were in charge. I supported it strongly. Now, obviously we're going very quickly in the other direction. They've already repealed some of President Obama's rules on clean coal industry. We're not going to be getting nationally to that point, but it can be done locally. I read, at the U of O that there was a discussion about divestment from fossil fuels. It's going to be a local movement, a lot like what we did with apartheid in South Africa, I think, at this point. We're not going to get the leadership at the national level, but if we build it up from the local level, ultimately it is going to happen at the national level. My handwriting is so bad. I really need to go back to school. The Climate Caucus, I have applied for membership. I have to find a Republican. People have already grabbed all of the regular and suspects. And there's a shortage. There's about 50 of us on the list wanting to be in the Climate Caucus, but they changed. And I was in the Climate Caucus until they changed the rules. And then they said, well, if you want to be in, you got to get a Republican. And I haven't been able to snag one yet, but I'm working on it. But it's a little bit difficult. The Dakota Access Pipeline, that to me is a travesty. And we did not recognize and I was fully supportive and vocally supportive of what President Obama did. Unfortunately, that was an executive order that could be undone by President Trump. What I did do on a more permanent basis is we passed a bill in December, the Water Resources Development Act, and I got an amendment in there that says in any future, I can't do retroactive legislation, but any future Corps of Engineers permitted project that crosses Native American lands, reservations, must and public consultation process with the sovereigns, with the tribes. So in the future, they're not going to be able to sneak stuff like that through. Unfortunately, at this point, I don't see how we undo it. The only way to undo that now would be through legislation, and obviously the Republicans in the House are not going there. So, and he also, I can't remember, he's doing so much stuff. I think he already said he's going to approve or did something on the Keystone XL pipeline too. So these are bad things that are happening. Elections have consequences, in this case, bad consequences. Yes?
Congressman DeFazio, your session is inspiration for me. My name is Samia, I come from Corvallis, and your inspiration is not only your votes, but your character. Thank you very much. So I have two questions for you. The first question, there is a sixth congressional seat after redistricting, will you stay covering Corvallis? Because if you do, we want you to stay covering us. If not, count me in. Well, I've been asking this a lot. The moral leadership that we have here in Corvallis is important, and we want it to be in Washington, and you are one of those who have the moral leadership. In the Constitution, you are one of those who can raise the Articles of Impeachment. It's a nuclear option. The word I is not something a politician will say easily. However, today, Muhammad Ali Jr. was detained. He was asked why, since he is a Muslim. I think our country, our American values are challenged. And I want you not to say, we will impeach Trump tomorrow or the day after. But I want you to say the following. If the administration does A, B, C, D, E, we won't impeach. We will tell our kids, we will tell the officials, the federal officials, that look, these are red lines. If you cross them, yes, we will use the nuclear option. So thank you very much again. I agree that you are one of those that my favorite congressman as well. So I look forward for your two answers.
Well, I'm energized for this election. I'm not giving you any commitments 2 years off, and I may prefer to a younger person by then. The issue of impeachment, this is important, and it goes back to what I talked about earlier. The surest way we're going to stop some of the most destructive things these people are doing and want to do, maybe the filibuster will hold in the Senate, and we can block a lot of it. Maybe the filibuster will even hold on the Supreme Court nominee. I don't know. The Republicans can change the rules. But we can maybe hold them off for 2 years, but if we don't win the elections 2 years from now, we probably can't hold them off for four. Because the Senate is got much bigger problems than the House. There are 10 senators up in very deep red states. And there are people saying, if they don't do everything I want a progressive to do, I'm going to work against them in the primary. That isn't going to work. You're not going to get a progressive in West Virginia or some of those other states. They're Democrats. They got damn good values. John Tester's a great guy. I don't agree with him on everything, but that's how we get to a majority, is we're going to have a big tent, which includes some people we don't agree with on everything, and they aren't as progressive as I am. I do not want to divert a tremendous amount of energy into an impeachment that cannot, at this point, happen. I've been there for impeachment. It's destructive. That's, it may be necessary. But when, we spent Ken Starr spent $70 million and handed the investigation of Whitewater, which became a sex case, to the Republicans. They said, now we can indict Bill Clinton. And they did. It takes a majority vote, and they had the evidence they needed. To go forward with a meaningful impeachment, you have to have evidence. We can't even get the Republicans in the beginning to look in the Senate. There might be something there. We can't get the tax returns because we're in the minority. There might be something there. Maybe the tax returns will get leaked, because he seems to be upsetting a bunch of people in the government, or works with the government, civil service. Then we'll have something to go from. But at this point, we don't have the evidence we need, and it requires a majority vote in the House after you have articles of impeachment, and a two-thirds vote in the Senate, which isn't going to happen. So at this point, let's keep our energy on something else, but we're going to keep pushing to get to the bottom of the emoluments clause, the Russian connection, and other very serious things. Not giving up on that. We can multitask.
Thank you so much.
So I throw it open. I don't
more familiar with this than I am, but you might have noticed in Portland that they came up with data about some very dangerous materials being put in the air by some glass recycling companies. And the DEQ said, you've got to clean it up. One of them closed, the other one's cleaning it up. So, I mean, in Oregon, the federal government has delegated to the state the enforcement of the Clean Air Act. Sarah, did you want to, I'm sorry, sort of moving there, like maybe she wanted to briefly address this. So let's bring her up.
Yes, Sarah. So our community has been great in terms of organizing around this issue, and I know it's been work that Neighbors for Clean Air have been working on for a very long time. And you really have made significant progress in the last couple of months. At the legislature, one of the things that I've done is to put some more pressure on DEQ to actually enforce permits. And rather than replying to exceeding the limits on a permit by raising the allowable number, to actually enforce the permit. Otherwise, what's the point of having a permit, right? And then the second thing is that we're working right now, or H&B is working right now through the city in the permitting process, and there will be consistent monitors on the stacks to look at the amount of fine particulate that is coming out, and new scrubbers will also be installed that will take out 99.96% of those small glass particulates. The side benefit of all of this is we're also getting neighborhood ambient monitoring so we can see what else is in the air in South Corvallis, because we are very concerned about the impact of public health in that area. We've got a lot of work to do. But that's all because of the work that this community has done to raise the issue both with the company and with DEQ. So thank you all so much for listening.
Congressman DeFazio, my name is Seth Bernstein. I'm from Corvallis, and I'm very excited about the work that you and other Democratic congressmen are doing and women are doing to win back the Congress. I am mystified by one thing. I'm hoping you can clear that up. The first thing that Democrats in Congress did after losing even more seats in the House was reelect Nancy Pelosi as their leader. And I'm by doing the same thing.
Well, we didn't lose seats, but we only picked up a few. And we should have picked up a lot more. Let me cycle back to 2010. That was the largest Democratic loss in the history of the United States of America, the history of the party. And the reaction of our leaders was, oh, that's such a horrible thing, it's such a crisis, people are so upset, we have to move up the leadership elections to the day we get back. And I was like, no. So I led a movement to delay the leadership elections, not exactly endearing myself with the leadership in doing that. And unfortunately, despite that, most of the people who would have supported me, I had lost their election. We lost 63 Democrats. A lot of the Blue Dog Democrats would get wiped out. So I made a major effort back then, and I didn't succeed. I had this conversation with some of my colleagues, to be truthful, and they said, well, she can raise so much money. She raised $250 million. And I said, you know what? The money doesn't matter anymore. Unfortunately, my views have not yet prevailed. So I'm taking it on as an individual, entrepreneur, as an elected member of Congress. And, you know, I stood up at the Democratic retreat 2 weeks ago, and Nancy's saying, you should all have town meetings. And I stood up and I said, no, excuse me, people shouldn't have town hall meetings, because if I do a town hall meeting, I can't have this conversation with you. And talk about how we're going to win back the House. I said, everybody should go home and have their campaign sponsor these meetings and talk about how we're going to take back America. And that's how.
actually is a good follow-on to his, because I wanted to talk about the DNC chair that was just announced a couple hours ago, Perez, and I wanted to get your thoughts on that and how he will lead us to winning back America.
Well, you know, the DNC traditionally has played the biggest role in presidential politics, and it's been the Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee or the Republican Congressional Campaign Committee that took the lead in the strategy and the organizing around those bodies, and there's similar organizations in the Senate. So the DNC can help. I remember when Howard Dean was chair, he had a 50-state strategy, and it worked. We took back the House of Representatives. And there was discussion of that during this. I think they had a healthy, a healthy election. Nobody trashed anybody, I was particularly intrigued by the mayor himself. Then, in the end, apparently he dropped out. I was kind of thinking big generational. I'm very interested in this. I didn't know him that well. I don't get a vote, so I didn't spend a lot of time on it. But what I saw intrigued me. I know Keith well, very progressive guy. She has a progressive caucus now. Secretary Perez was good for working people and working in labor rights and all that. I haven't studied, in depth, his platform or his past positions, because I didn't have a vote in this. So, but he made Keith deputy, and I think this is going to be a healthy healing process. Bringing the party back together between the Hillary wing and the Bernie wing, and we've got to come together, and we've got to attract other people. There's a lot more people down here in line, so I can go back to the other people up there. So go ahead.
Join one of those groups or create
this is not something that, that will enjoy majority support in this country. Yes?
Hi, Senator Clinton. My name is Sarah Finger McDonald, and
a
minute ago, I would guess that the
you know, like the American Farm Bureau does not represent your interests. You know, there is an alternate organization, the name escapes you in a moment, a much more progressive organization, mostly of smaller farms and farmers and ranchers who come by every year. But the Farm Bureau is really a big business, industrial business kind of. And at this point, I think some of those people are thinking, well, yeah, it's going to hurt my business somewhat, but on the other hand, boy, am I going to get a tax cut, or am I going to get this, or am I going to get freed of, like, for instance, they're already talking about overturning the Waters of the U.S. rule, which farmers claim is very detrimental to them. Actually, I sat through some, this is the jurisdiction of my committee, and some very long hearings, and got the former head of the EPA to point out that farm on this area, and I said, well, that should be categorically exempt, because it's previously farmed land. And there's, well, the Corps of Engineers, and whatever, and I got the head of the EPA to say, no, under the new rules we're writing, that farm would be categorically exempt. It's the confusion of the Bush rules, which isn't allowing that person to farm there. Well, if they repeal the new Waters of the U.S. rule of Obama, which protects wetlands, but also allows farming in a regular basis, then they're actually going to be detrimental. So there's a lot of things going on that don't quite add up or make sense, and people don't have good information. But you raised an incredible point. I think it's become very evident this summer. Second thing, Social Security. Bernie Sanders and I introduced a bill last week to improve, protect, and perpetuate Social Security indefinitely. Now. This, Social Security has a problem because of demographics. In 2034, we're projecting that Social Security will go to a cash flow basis instead of a trust fund basis. And on a cash flow basis with current projections, we'll only have money to pay about 75-77% of promised benefits. That's not good. And it's taken a lot of young people to say, well, why should I pay? And it's never going to be there. Well, it's going to be there. It's going to be there in a reduced way. But that doesn't have to happen. Now, there's probably only four solutions I can think of. Three of them I reject. One is, people say, oh, let's just raise the retirement age again. Yeah, out there at age 70, logging, that's going to go on, or fishing, or farming, ranching. No, we're not going to raise the retirement age again. Well, we'll just cut benefits. Well, if you look at, the resources that people have, particularly my generation, the baby boom, people are becoming more and more dependent on Social Security in retirement instead of less dependent on Social Security because they've lost traditional pensions. A lot of them lost their savings in the crash on Wall Street. They don't earn enough to put security. In fact, they need a more robust Social Security, and I'll get to that in a second. The third way they'll say, well, let's just give it to Wall Street. They'll that works real well, too. No, so those are non-starters, but there's only one other solution. Increase the income to Social Security. Here's the thing, there's a cap. You get to $127,200, you don't pay Social Security taxes anymore. It's kind of a tax loophole, you might say. LeBron James, a friend of mine who runs the National Committee to Preserve Social Security and Medicare, came up with this, so I don't want to give a good attribution to Max. LeBron James stops paying Social Security at the end of the first quarter in his first game of the year. And that's not to mention Wall Street billionaires like Robert Mercer. So on February 16th, when Bernie and I introduced this bill, anybody who earns just $1 million a year stopped paying Social Security taxes on February 16th. That's earned income. So lift the cap. And we even added a little something, because we really want to improve benefits. We're going to tax unearned income over $250,000 a year.
Yeah.
Under Social Security. The money we'll raise, and this has been confirmed by the Social Security actuaries, will make Social Security solvent 100% with a new cost of living index that would have given a 5 times greater real cost of living increase this year. That's called the CPIE. That's in our bill. And we increase benefits for low-income earners who are becoming more and more dependent upon Social Security by changing their replacement formula. We can do all that, and we can have solvency for 60 years into the future by just lifting the cap. Yeah.
premiums have risen this year to 25% of my income. And that doesn't include my $7,000 annual deductible. So, my question is, what would persuade me to co-sponsor HR 676, the National Medicare for All Bill?
Actually, I have a different approach, and you know, Medicare is in trouble. You might realize right now. So I've got a different approach. The House bill had provisions that were way better than the Senate bill. The unfortunate death of Teddy Kennedy and a filibuster in the Senate stuck us with the Senate bill. I was one of the last people to agree to vote for it because I didn't think it was a great bill. I thought we could do a lot better. The House bill had national exchanges and a key element. It had a national, not-for-profit, public plan option. Now that, in my mind, led us to single payer. Because people would have said, well, I could go to Blue Cross Blue Shield and pay more and get fewer benefits, or I could go to this national, public plan, not-for-profit option and pay less and get the same or better benefits. So we couldn't negotiate, you know, we couldn't negotiate with the Senate. We had to take their bill. I'm going to introduce that freestanding. Because Republicans have moved from, as I said earlier, from repeal to repeal, replace, whatever, blah, 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 blah. Repair now. Well, here's a repair. Let's have that. Let's have a national option, which I think people would gravitate to, and it would show that we could have single payer. But at this point, first off, John Conyers' bill has no way, it doesn't pay for anything. He has no pay for the bill. Like, he hasn't figured out, thanks to Obamacare, was scheduled to go broke next year. Trust fund would be exhausted. It's now not scheduled to go broke until 2028. But we've got big problems with Medicare that we've got to fix. Among them, Medicare Part D, which I voted against, not because I don't think seniors need prescription drug coverage, but because the Republicans passed that and prohibited the government from negotiating lower prices for pharmaceuticals. So if we're going to go to Medicare for all, first we've got to fix Medicare, because it's in big trouble right now, and we've got to perpetuate it. But for now, in this debate over the Affordable Care Act, I'm offering this that provision, which I think could lead us ultimately to single payer, which would make sense.
Hello, Congressman. My name is Lady Pryor from Panoma, and I too just filed my papers to become to run for school board.
Thanks, that's a good question. You know, one of the consequences of the 2010 blowout was all across the spectrum, not only Congress, but it was state legislators and governorships everywhere. So many states became all red and then gerrymandered. What they do is they say, let's take all the Democrats and put them in this district, that's called packing, and then let's draw these bizarre configurations to capture all these areas. And make safe Republican seats. It led to a very perverse result, which is, yeah, they won. But now, for many, I have won of probably 65 competitive seats out of 435 in the House. I mean, that's pretty pathetic. And it's because of gerrymandering, Kurt Schrader's district. We have two, I mean, his was competitive, it's about the same as mine. And, you know, because of that, there's a whole new term, which is being primary, which has, and this is all part of, like, in America, can represent democracy survive. We need to do away with gerrymandering, and we could do that, and I want to build nationally. Driven the Republicans to the right, and Democrats pretty much to the left. We used to have a lot of people who overlapped. We had a lot of Republicans who voted more liberal than Blue Dog Democrats, and we have Blue Dog Democrats voting more conservative than liberal Republicans. That doesn't happen anymore because people are driven, they're worried about being primary. So that's a huge issue. In the case of these three districts, I'm only particularly familiar with one. I think the other two are pretty deep red and not ripe yet. But Mr. Price's district outside Atlanta, I talked to John Lewis about this because John is in the next district over. John Lewis thinks we can win that district because it's one of the most highly educated districts in America. It was a district that went for Hillary, although Price won by a very large margin, a Republican. That is going to be a target race. I think the primary is sometime in March. At this point, they have what's called a jungle primary, which means that I think there's 12 Republicans and one Democrat so far, and the top two vote people will go into the general election, which will be in May. So that is becoming, I think, will be a target for us, and that would send a shockwave through the Republican ranks if we could do that. So I don't know, the other two I haven't heard much talk about, I'll have to look, but I think they're very deep red. I don't think we're going to put resources in with this now. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Congressman DeFazio, thanks for being here. I'm Gary Winehouse. I live just across the river in Linn County. Is there any way to begin at least rolling back the privatization of some of our institutions like prisons and the military?
President Obama had directed the Attorney General to do no further private prison contracts, and in fact to basically get out of the private prison contracts. Our so-called Attorney General, Jeff Sessions, has just reversed that rule and saying we're all in for private prisons. Private prisons are run for profit. It's really a penal institution run for profit. That means that many times they are more dangerous for the inmates. They don't have any, they don't try to do anything to rehabilitate people. They just incarcerate people and treat them miserably. They're dangerous places many times. And, it's a very, very bad thing. The military, same thing, used to have, the contractors, there's a great book, I met the guy about 5 or 6 years ago that he wrote after the Iraq War, sort of exposing all of the unbelievable cost and waste with these contractors. Of course, one of the most famous was Blackwater, and it turns out that Blackwater with Eric Prince happens to be Betsy DeVos's mother. So unfortunately, right now, we're going to be fighting very much a rear guard action on this. They'll do what they can do administratively. We haven't tested Congress on this issue, so I can't predict that. I got to think that there are some of my colleagues on the other side of the aisle, best thing, but I don't know. We haven't tested that issue yet. We will see. Yes.
Thank you, Representative DeFazio from the Public Service, for sponsoring this forum. I'm Josh Strayden from Lebanon, and I actually also had a question about healthcare, and I wanted to likewise encourage you to consider H.R. 676 for the following reason. While I believe the public option is a marvelous idea, in the end, what I fear may happen, in looking at the risk pool, it may become a high-risk pool, which would be far more expensive, and then the private industry and those in Congress will say, see, we told you so, it's not sustainable, you're just raising your taxes, we're not going to consider a public option. I think the ideal that we can seek for, and should seek for, is an improved Medicare for all, as everyone inside of the same risk pool, those are high risk and low risk, are all in the same pool, so we all absorb and take care of each other. Just wondering, can you tell us?
In their repeal discussions, they have been talking about two things. One is risk pools. Risk pools have historically been a disaster. In states, they are underfunded, the premiums are very expensive, and they don't get much coverage. So anything that moves toward a risk pool would be bad. Secondly, they're talking about selling insurance across state lines, which means a race to the bottom, which means that they'll be offering budget policies that sound great but don't really cover anything being offered by someone based in Mississippi. And good luck if you buy a policy there, no problem. Or you don't have one, but don't worry about it. So that's, you know, that's those are major issues. I gotta be real candid here. That bill was written 15, 20 years ago. It's not a thoughtful bill. It doesn't thoughtfully approach what we would do if we were gonna have Medicare for all. And I just don't put my name on legislation that isn't well written. It's not. I'm open to looking at other ways of improving. I've already talked about a couple, Medicare stabilizing its finances and then looking at expanding it. But since we're having a debate about now repairing the ACA as opposed to repealing it, maybe. The Republicans are very split on this. There's 50 Republicans in the House that say, we don't care what happens, repeal it now. So I don't know how they're going to put it together. So it's going to be interesting and distressing to watch. But I'm going to contribute to that debate with two things. I've reintroduced that. Paul Ryan says we'll have competition. I said, how do you have competition when the industry is exempt from antitrust laws? So I've reintroduced my subject, the industry, to antitrust. And I'm going to throw something in the mix, which is let's have a public plan national exchange auction. Part of the problem with the exchanges is that that should have been done state by state. We would have avoided a disaster here in Oregon. It should have been national. You have bigger pools, and you're going to have lower rates, and you can distribute the risk better. So I'm throwing into that debate. I'm open to anybody who wants to work on a thoughtful approach on Medicare. But with Paul Ryan proposing privatized Medicare, that's not going anywhere right now, I'll tell you. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
So I'm very concerned about climate data and gag orders that seem to be, I don't know all the details on. And I've had a thought, I don't know if this is quite the forum, but I thought, why not share it, because it's an idea that needs to get out there. It's very important. This data is how we know what's going on this planet. And scientists, knowing a number of scientists myself, these are people who are collecting this data because they care and they want to do service to the rest of humanity. And I know that there are ventures being organized by people, Silicon Valley, I think MIT, University of Penn, to safeguard, capture all the government data that might get wiped or possibly is in the process of getting wiped, and they're moving it into data refuges and possibly actually organizing it at even higher levels so that it can be actually more use. I'm even do sort of like what the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence did in the 90s and developed a little application that would allow people to download data processing, a little app onto their computer that generates a screensaver that. So Trump wants to get rid of this data and make it invisible and put us all in the dark. That little app could actually generate screensavers that everybody in America could see that data right on their computer screens.
Can
we use something like
that? I've heard, I mean, that's obviously beyond the purview of Congress, but I've heard about that effort. I just met a woman at my last rally, whose mom is a climate scientist, and she talked about her mom's involvement at UCLA, and UCLA is also involved in trying to accumulate and safeguard the data. It's a very real threat. These people, just like they're trying to discredit the real press in favor of, the fake press or Breitbart News, so-called, they're going to try and take away the tools we have to prove that we are destroying our planet and our planet's future. At this point, it's a great private initiative. And, scientists don't tend to be particularly political, but they seem real threat here, and they're getting a little more political. In fact, there's a talk about a day of action by scientists sometime this spring, I think, around the season.
There you go.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, this is sort of water under the bridge. Boy, if I was president or dictator or whatever in 2008, I would love to have done it this way. But I have a feeling, given the way things are going, we may have another opportunity sooner than we think. In 2008, in my fantasy world, instead of spending $1 trillion to bail out Wall Street, I think it's so important that, everybody, the way we could flip this equation in so many ways is that people actually fell in love with the planet they lived on. And boy, wouldn't it have been great to have a $1 trillion jobs program like the WBA, but where people went to work, not even just building freeways, but actually restoring ecosystems.
The other bill, which was over $800 billion, was the American Recovery Act. Started out as a pretty good idea, and it was to rebuild a lot of things. It was to help rebuild schools and build new schools to educate our kids in. It had water infrastructure, clean water, sewer, wastewater. It had a large investment in our transportation infrastructure, which includes roads, bridges, highways, and transit. We have an $84 billion backlog just to bring existing transit up to a state of good repair, let alone give people new transit options. That doesn't even include Amtrak and rail. There's huge needs there. And this jerk, Larry Summers, who for whatever reason Obama hired as his economic advisor, came to our caucus and he said, "Got a great idea. We're not going to do it the way Bush did." And we're saying, "What are you talking about, Larry?" So we're not going to send everybody a rebate check. Because they might not spend it, they might save it, they might pay down debt. We're going to give them tax cuts so small they don't notice. And so I jumped up because Harvard was so right when they fired him. And I said, "Larry, that's great." I said, "Not only is that bad economics, what's $12 a week per person going to do to put people back to work unless you call it the Barista Full Employment Act?" Secondly, I said, "That's bad politics." And guess what? When we lost the House in 2010, 89% of the people thought their taxes had gone up, and 89% of the people had gotten a tax break that they didn't notice, that didn't put anybody back to work. I was one of the very few Democrats, I think maybe the only Democrat, to vote against that, because I said, "This is, we could do so much here, putting people back to work." And what you're talking about in terms of restoring ecosystems, we have groups who do that that they're proposing to defund. Some of our youth employment programs, like Youth Corps, Job Corps, AmeriCorps, they do stuff like that now. Young people get a chance to volunteer and do that. The Republicans want to kill all those programs. Yeah, we should be doing a heck of a lot more of that. I marvel, and there's still a lot of places around. I was hiking down in Arizona, took a few days off with my wife last week, and we hiked on a trail that had been built by the CCC, and it's still there, and it's still amazing. So we need to make it very and just back to the bailout of Wall Street, I think it was that's really where the Tea Party got going, although there was Koch money behind the whole thing altogether, and they had a different agenda, but that's what really got people going. When you see people losing their houses we could have solved that problem for a fraction of the price if we had just said, "Okay, these people will buy the houses." The amount of money that was out in bad loans was a tiny fraction of the bailout because Wall Street had created,
using Oella terminology, basically imaginary collateralized debt obligations. They made the stuff up because there weren't enough bad loans to go around, and investors wanted them, so they created virtual bad loans that you could bet on. And that's, so they made the crisis 10 times worse. We could have just said anybody who bet on a virtual bad loan, good luck, but we are going to underwrite that asset, and for people who didn't abuse the system, we're going to keep them in their homes. We would have a different country today if that had been the case.
About 2 years ago, had a whole hour devoted to how people on disability are faking it. There was recently an article in a major publication saying that there was a link between, and this is crazy, between people being on disability and the rise of Nazism. And the rise of Nazism. This was in the Washington Post, I believe. And I'm not going to get into it, but it's crazy.
I don't think it's, I mean, it's just like there's things that were in the Post that are crazy, but I don't think the Post.
Well, it wasn't a comment. But my concern is, and another thing, Medicaid affects us. My Medicare premium is covered by Medicaid. So all of the problems that face senior citizens and poor people are being faced by people like me, and I believe there's 11 million of us on this in your country. So can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. My background is actually in rehabilitation counseling. I wrote my master's paper on the Social Security disability determination process and the problems with it. I used to work as an advocate for Congressman Jim Weaver, fighting to get people their disability benefits that they'd earned that Social Security was trying to deny. So I'm intimately familiar with it. We have a two-year backlog of people getting adjudication of their Social Security disability cases. We don't have enough administrative law judges. The law judges don't have clerks. So people are, you know, losing their homes or, you know, other things are happening to them in that interim process. I am a very strong advocate and very aware of these issues. I should be in talking quickly, and I'll just try and put in seniors and disabled in the future of my rhetoric, but I'm very, very well aware of that. I had some severely disabled people at my first town hall who were on the verge of tears at the prospect of losing the Oregon health plan. So I am intimately familiar with it. I know how vital it is, and I'll just be more careful to include, make a more expansive statement when I say
students
and disabled and survivor children.
I want to let you know that I'm aware that you are a big advocate for the disabled. Yeah. I was just curious why it's not brought up.
Well, you're right, there is some, there are people trying to allege that there's a bunch of people, you know, on disability who don't deserve it and they aren't really disabled. I tell you, that process, getting through that process, I was working with a guy when I worked for Jim Weaver, not on his staff yet, nervous because we're going over time and they, we have to clear out his book, but he had been a gunsmith. He had severe uncontrolled diabetes, he had diabetic retinopathy. Him being gunsmith, and he was so uncontrolled, they virtually had a fatal diagnosis, and he was denied. And I actually went up to Salem, where the disability determination is done, and I said, I want to see this guy's files. I don't think you've got the right documents in there. And I was working for Congressman, that got their attention, and we got him with benefits. But it shouldn't have to be that way, so I'm really familiar. Staff has really given me the hook.
One more.
We rented this room and they told us we had to be up at 4. Go ahead, quick, press it up above.
Thank you. My name is Tom Delato. I'm a horticultural scientist specializing in cannabis in rural Boone County. The cannabis industry is the only industry that I know of that's regulated to be grown, manufactured, sold, and consumed in the United States. But now we found out this week that the America First administration has decided to restart the war on marijuana at adult use, at least. And Mr. Spicer used some 1937 alternative facts to back up his claim, which contradict the fact that, you know, in Oregon, at least, the cannabis industry generated over $60 million of revenue last year, even before the program got fully implemented. And it reduces opium use and opium addiction. It gives a lot of money to law enforcement. It allows law enforcement to direct their energies to enforce actual crimes. So I'm asking you, what will you be doing to help protect this this thriving American-made industry?
I strongly supported both the years ago medical marijuana and supported the recreational initiatives. I'm a proud member of the Cannabis Caucus
in Congress. Our one and only Earl Blumenauer. And every year, one of the big I've had with the cannabis growers in my district, or a number of them, not all of them, but their greatest problem, one of their greatest problems under the current system is they can't use the banking system. And every year, Earl offers an amendment to allow people in this industry to use the banking system. And I vote for it every year, and every year we get a few more votes. So we'll be offering it again this year and fighting it, and I will fight Mr. Sessions. Funny thing about some of my roots, until a state does something they don't like. States' rights issue is what he said, and so we're going to try and hold him to that, like many other promises that may prove to have not been quite true. But anyway, we go real quick, and then we're going to get drug out of here, or they're going to find you or something.
Thank you so much for being here, and thank you so much for your conversation. It's very stimulating and inspiring. I have a question. I'm a human rights activist, retired person, and a human rights activist in Corvallis. And I've been worried lately about a bill that's sweeping the country, and they're called Combating BDS. And I'm very happy that my senator, State Senator Sarah Gelser, was posing such a bill to be introduced in Oregon. But senators, it's called Combating BDS, and if there are bills that are trying to restrict Americans' right to practice boycott, divestment, and sanctions against the state of Israel, the apartheid government, occupation, 50-year occupation against the indigenous Palestinian people. Well, Senator Rubio, Marcus Rubio, and Joe Manchin has introduced a bill in the Senate, U.S. Senate, under the same name, Combating BDS. It's S-170, and it's just been introduced, so I don't know how much conversation there's been. It is in a committee. I can't remember the name of the committee, sorry about that. But I want to ask you, and I know that Representative Betty McCollum's letter to appoint a special envoy to Palestine from the United States to address the issue of children in military detention in the West Bank and Palestine. And you also were supportive of Obama's extension on the United Nations 2334, basically taking Israel to task for its occupation and its treatment of Palestinians. I would like to know, should this bill come to a vote in the Congress, Combating BDS, that would take away it would take away the right to practice BDS, but it would put restrictions on it. And I don't want to get into, I know we're running short on time. So I want to know how you...
Well, I haven't seen the bill, but as you describe it, I would pose that I'm not aware that it's been introduced in the House. It may have been, it may not have been. I don't follow the Senate bills. There's already a couple thousand bills in the House, and I don't even know all of them. So in any case, the way you described it, I would oppose it. I'm sorry, but we are going to, they were very, very strict about this room, saying we had to be out here. I don't know whether they got another